Toronto, 2008, and another honour for multi-award winning record producer, composer and arranger, Quincy Jones.
Quincy Jones is proof of the greatness of a single human being.
He's unbelievable. You can't believe what he's done. You can't.
His roots were all about jazz. His destiny was all about music.
He's one of the sort of the few people left that's a living legend, you know.
It's music that stood the test of time. Soul Bossa Nova from the 60s was used in the recent Austin Powers films.
Mr. Jones, you've got to get your mojo working overtime, baby.
Quincy Jones produced Michael Jackson's albums in the 80s, including the best-selling album of all time.
One thing that I think that worked for us was we didn't have time for paralysis from analysis. We made Thriller in 8 weeks.
But Quincy's career started long before Thriller. In the 50s and 60s, he was a band leader, composer, and arranger.
I never know when Quincy's done the things, you know. I read about it in the paper, I go, oh, God, he did that. I didn't know, you know. Like Fly Me to the Moon, I didn't know.
Fly me to the moon.
He worked with all the great artists, from Frank Sinatra to Dinah Washington to Ray Charles.
In the heat of the night.
He composed the scores of many memorable films. He was the first black executive in the record industry, and he's been producing for 40 years.
If you just could hit it a little bit more, articulate a little bit more, because I heard you do it once. But now
we've brought about a twist. He's embraced every genre of music, jazz, soul, funk, pop, and rap, and become a successful film and television producer with hits like The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air.
Now this is a story all about how my life got flipped, turned upside down.
He's covered so much ground as a musician, as a producer, as a record guy, as a family man. I mean, he's covered so much ground, it's almost impossible to think is he still here.
This two-part series explores the rags-to-riches story of Quincy Jones, who, through his 7 decades of music, has won more Grammy Awards than any other living artist. Quincy Jones began his professional career in New York in 1951 with a Lionel Hampton band. He was just 18.
It was like being in heaven to be with all those musicians. They had musicians that had been with all the big bands, you know.
Quincy had joined one of the hottest bands of the day at the best venue in town, Harlem's legendary Apollo Theater, where crowds flocked to see their jazz heroes.
Lionel Hampton was bigger than Louis Armstrong, Duke Ellington, or Count Basie at that time. He went for the throat, and he was not happy until he had everybody jumping out of their seats off the ceiling.
Quincy was already writing music at 18. His first recorded piece was The Kingfish, co-written with his bandleader Lionel Hampton.
That's the first record I ever made. First record I ever made. I wrote the arrangement, wrote the tune, and played. First record I ever made in my life, y'all. 18.
Touring with Lionel Hampton, Quincy learned about a musician's life on the road.
I used to just shut up and listen and watch what the older guys did, you know, how to survive on the road. They'd take their pants and fold their pants and put it under the mattress at night before they went to bed. that we have wash and wear shirts. You'd wash your shirt out and hang it on the shower. And the same with your coat, and steam it, put the hot water on to steam it, and you wash your handkerchief and wring it out and put it on the mirror. And the next morning, it was like it had been pressed. And I learned all this from these guys. I mean, I just watched everything they did. And you have to learn your music, how to read your music fast, because if you have to read your music, you can't see the girls. And if you memorize your parts, you can look around and see what's going on, you know. I learned that from the old guys, too. Learn how to read your music fast, really fast.
Singer Ernestine Anderson sometimes performed with the band.
He always had a number of things going on in his head at one time, and you know, we used to like, wait a minute.
The band often toured the Southern American states, which had racial segregation laws.
All through the South, it was terrible. All the water fountains were white and colored. The bus stations were white and colored. The restaurants, forget about it. You know, we'd always just have white bus drivers to go get us food in the restaurants. I hadn't seen that kind of stuff before. We hit this one city when the sun first came up, and from the biggest church steeple in the city was an effigy of a black dummy with a rope around his neck. You know, it was no joke. I'm serious, honey.
It all came as a shock to a boy who'd been born in the North. Quincy Delight Jones Jr. entered the world on the 14th of March, 1933, a healthy new citizen of Chicago. Thousands of African Americans migrated here to escape the segregation of the South. Quincy's origins are typical of those whose ancestors were slaves.
But that's what used to happen on plantations, you know. Our family is black, French, Cherokee Indian, and Welsh.
This was the golden age of jazz. Great band leaders like Duke Ellington and Count Basie played on the radio and toured America, often with singers like the legendary Billie Holiday.
Hey there, baby, make up your mind, 'cause I've been waiting such a long, long time. Now, baby, or never.
Quincy Jones Sr., a skilled carpenter, loved the dance halls and juke joints. His mother, Sarah, was intelligent and highly educated.
My mother, brilliant, brilliant woman. She went to the University of Boston in the 20s, which is very rare for a black woman, and knew languages, multi-languages. She was very smart.
Quincy had a brother, Lloyd, who was 2 years his junior.
I felt an innate instinct to protect him all the time because I somehow could feel his vulnerability even when I was very young. And every picture we'd taken, I'm holding him like, don't you come near him.
There was a great deal to protect his brother from. Their mother suffered from schizophrenia.
My mother went to a mental hospital when I was 7, when my brother was 6 or 5. We were so young, we didn't really understand what's going on until we got there and we saw these people. Heavy, really heavy. And I don't know how to explain it. It's just, I remember they took her away and they put her in a straitjacket. And we used to visit her out to the mental home. It made it very clear right up front that there would be no mother in my life. I don't know what the word means.
It was a difficult period for Quincy's father, and he took the boys to rural Kentucky for a year to live with his mother.
No electricity, kerosene lamps, coal stove, water, ice on the floors and all that stuff.
Life was tough. They were so poor, they'd eat anything.
Oh yeah, like rats. You know, but at 7, you don't care. You know, it tastes pretty good. I mean, if you're hungry, honey, you don't sit around and argue about foie gras.
On their return to Chicago, life remained tough. The black ghetto wasn't the safest place to grow up.
I remember 7 years old when a gang from the next block took my hand and a switchblade and pinned it to a wooden fence. My daddy hit him with a hammer, you know. That's the kind of neighborhood it was.
Corruption and violence were rife in Chicago. Quincy's father did carpentry work for the local mob.
That's what we wanted to be. Are you kidding everybody in Chicago? And I mean, some tough brothers back then, you know.
In 1943, Quincy's father decided to take his boys away from all that. It was wartime, and Quincy's father was one of many who found work at a naval shipyard just west of Seattle. Suburban Seattle was safer than Chicago, but young Quincy and Lloyd had plenty of time to get into trouble.
We were little raggedy thugs, but we were trying to act grown up like Chicago. And that's what got me into music, you know.
One fateful day, 11-year-old Quincy broke into a military store looking for food. What he found instead was to shape his future.
We individually went around and started to break in. And I broke into one of the supervisor's rooms and saw a little spinet piano over in the corner. And I almost closed the door. And God's whisper says, "Maniac, go back in that room." It's like an intuition. I call it God's whispers, but it said, "Go back in there." It changed my life. And I went over to the piano, and the first time I ever touched it, it's like every drop of blood and it's my heart and soul and every cell in my body said, "This is what you're going to do the rest of your life."
His half-brother, Richard, has seen how important music has been to Quincy throughout his life.
His mother became music because it was always there. He could create the image of what motherhood through music would represent for him at any point in time of his life. So he could always surround himself and encapsulate himself in a blanket of love and the mother image he created through his music.
Quincy's father married a woman with three children, and they had three children of their own. There were now eight children in the Jones family, including Richard, now a federal judge.
Ours is a blended family, and the children never saw a distinction. We were brothers and sisters straight across the board. I think as Quincy grew up, he perceived different treatment. As a result of that, he had challenges, strained circumstantial relationships with my mother.
Separated from his mother and not getting on with his stepmother, Quincy took refuge in music.
From there on in, stayed in there practicing piano, and I found a saxophone player. He played with me. Then after school, I stayed after school and learned how to play sousaphone, tuba, baritone, B-flat baritone, E-flat alto, French horn, trombone. Tried woodwinds and violins, couldn't use it, you know. And percussion, we played percussion through timpani and all that stuff. Just addicted, totally addicted.
He settled on the trumpet, the coolest instrument of the day, and the one played by his idol, Dizzy Gillespie. Quincy now lived in central Seattle, where he joined a junior band run by Bumps Blackwell. His school friend, Buddy Catlett, played saxophone.
We were 15, all of us, Quincy and I, are the same age. And there were laws that say you had to be 21 to get in a drinking establishment. And in order to make any money, that's where you had to play. So that's why we didn't advertise and tried to act as cool as possible.
We had to play all kinds of music. We played rhythm and blues, shottishes, bar mitzvah, pop music, stripper music, everything. That's what was happening. We were working all the nightclubs, you know.
Bounce Blackwell Band was a pretty good band. We got some, worked in some pretty high-powered situations.
The band used to rehearse in Bumps Blackwell's own house.
He had two bedrooms that I remember, a den, a living room, a rehearsal room we had, and all the freedom to have friends over.
All girls, since way back when, liked the Bad Boys. And we were the Bad Boys. Because we were playing in nightclubs at night and all that. We had all the girls.
We'd end up with girls that were much older than us from where we played. And that's the way that went.
I was with 35-year-old girls when I was 15. Older ones I loved. They were hot.
Well, it don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing. Shoo-ba-doo-bop, 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 shoo-ba-doo-wow.
Quincy modeled himself on jazz musicians like Duke Ellington, seen here on tour in rare home movies on his way to Seattle.
I used to play hooky and go down to the Palomar Theater. Everybody worked down there. And I just wanted to be around real musicians, you know. And then Ray Charles came to town. He was 16 when I met him, and we just locked. Ray had his own apartment. I was still living at home. He had a record player, two suits, two girlfriends. I said, he was 100 years older than me, you know.
I love his energy. And he really loved music. And he wanted to learn how to write music. And of course, I knew how to write, and that's really what drew us together.
I used to stay up and write at night till my eyes bled, you know. I just love writing music.
Ray remained a lifelong friend. Count Basie also took an interest in the teenage composer and became Quincy's mentor. He even bought one of his compositions.
Basie sat down one day and said, "Young blood, here's the facts of life, you know." He said, "We take care of each other because nobody stays on top. Nobody stays on top."
It was around this time that Quincy started dating his schoolmate, Jerry Caldwell.
Jerry was beautiful. She was always at a water fountain, you know, trying to connect, you know. And she was at this water fountain, and we went around, and then finally we started talking to each other and hanging out.
Some of the guys that would like to have dated Jerry couldn't because she was with Quincy, some of the white football heroes especially.
Jerry's parents didn't like her dating an African-American, but the couple defied them.
Quincy had to meet her mother. And they got all their little differences straightened out, said he was in love and they wanted to get married.
Their plan was to leave home and find work. Quincy was already known to musicians who played Seattle. In 1951, he landed the job with Lionel Hampton that launched his professional career. At 18, he was playing in one of America's top bands. Jerry followed Quincy to New York, but the city authorities wouldn't let them marry straight away, claiming their papers weren't in order. The couple lived together regardless, braving prejudice and disapproval. Quincy toured with Lionel Hampton for the next 2 years, sometimes overseas. But in 1953, when Jerry gave birth to their daughter, Jolie, he left the band and settled back in New York.
Did you hear about Jerry?
Quincy knew the actor and singer Harry Belafonte, who'd also arrived in town.
New York City was a great place. Ideas were constantly fermenting. Things were exploding. The jazz scene was big with Miles Davis and Charlie Parker. There was so much diversity, so much going on. It was probably the most exciting city in the world to be in.
Beboppers like Miles Davis were all about improvisation, a far cry from big band swing.
You cared more about what the other jazz musician felt about you than you did about the audience. Because beboppers did not like the conforming, you know, and they also didn't want to roll their eyes and dance and entertain people. They wanted to become pure artists. It didn't work. That's why most of them ended up using heroin. Starting with Charlie Parker, who was the most revolutionary musician in our history. He died at 35 of overdose.
Jazz musicians and drugs went hand in hand, and Quincy was no exception.
We tried everything walking. And back then, everybody did, you know. Every idol we had was a junkie, you know. Everyone. Ray, 30 years, you know, on heroin. I was lucky that after 5 months, I fell down 5 flights of steps, and the trumpet player, that's what you call ghetto rehab. I said, there'll be no more of that, because a trumpet player can fall down 5 flights of steps, that means you might not be able to play again, you know. So that fixed that.
In fact, Quincy was moving away from playing the trumpet to concentrate on composing and orchestrating. He was spotted by one of the greatest stars of the day, Dinah Washington.
My lean baby, he's so slim, a broomstick so wide compared to him, but when he starts to kiss me, then I...
Dinah played a key role in Quincy's career, encouraging him to move into record production.
She's the one really that introduced me as a professional arranger in the recording business, you know.
Dinah was also a champion of the singer Patty Austin, then a child star.
I knew that she was very much a promoter of his talent, wanted to push him forward with his arranging skills, and, you know, she was all about that, constantly promoting him.
I remember the first record I did with her was... I loved my trombone playing daddy with his big, long sliding thing. I mean, Dinah was just doing a lot of these little naughty songs, you know.
You know my daddy, he's that trombone playing man. Where is my daddy? Tell me, where is my daddy with that big, long sliding thing?
And the relationship was not entirely about music.
Yes. As far as I know, from my very youthful perspective, yeah, there was a serious bonding. There was a lot of bonding going on with Quincy and many, many, and many, many people of the female persuasion. Yes.
I'm mad about the boy.
7 times married Dinah didn't seem troubled that Quincy had Jerry and a baby at home.
Mad about the boy. I'm so ashamed of it.
Their affair didn't last long. But Dinah and Quincy remained friends, making 10 albums together before she died in 1963. At 23, Quincy was one of the most sought-after arrangers in New York, working with musicians he'd idolized as he grew up. Jazz photographer Herman Leonard documented those years.
Quincy is not a giant physically. He's a giant musically. And when I saw people like Gene Krupa and Oscar Peterson, these really highly accomplished musicians, hovering over him as he would explain something, and I said, this fellow is endowed with genius because they really respect him.
Quincy began to make albums under his own name. In 1956, This Is How I Feel About Jazz sounded fresh and modern.
His stuff was a little more advanced than what I had been hearing from big bands at that time. There was a particular arrangement called Stockholm Sweetening that I really loved. The textures that he used in his arranging were intriguing to me, the way he mixed different qualities of horns together, and plus some things that I actually learned from Q, as we call him, harmonically, you know, at that time, helped my growth as a musician.
Quincy's reputation was growing, and in 1956, a government initiative put him center stage in the jazz world. The idea was to promote American culture around the world. It followed a landmark ruling that schools could no longer be racially segregated.
One of the people who we're planning to use, my friend Dizzy Gillespie, who's the father of modern jazz.
Dizzy Gillespie asked me to organize his band. I was 23 years old, and a Dizzy Gillespie junkie from the time I picked up a horn.
The weapon that we would use is the cool one. This is the cool weapon that we would use.
It was the first time that black people had been sent abroad to represent their country, and Quincy was second in command.
It was like a kamikaze black band. They sent us to the worst places politically. Abadan, Tehran, Karachi, Dhaka, Beirut. We played the entire Middle East.
His thoughts often turned to home and family.
The postcards you'd send to my father, the pictures you'd send to my father, the letters pouring out love and the different travels that he experienced across the planet.
All the time he was away, Quincy carried this photo of Jerry in his wallet. She had given it to him when he left school. They were finally married in 1957, when Quincy returned to New York. It was a great relief for Jerry, who'd faced daily prejudice as the unmarried mother of a mixed-race child. But career always came first for Quincy, and soon he was off to France alone. He'd accepted a job with the Paris-based company Barclay Records, where he worked alongside the composer, Michel Legrand.
Every American, when you play a band, came to Paris, and even some stayed in Paris, because there was no segregation in France at all. So the black players were much nicely received in France or in Europe. This is why they love to come.
It was here that Quincy had the freedom to study formal composition. Classical music was a largely closed world to black people in America. But in France, Quincy studied with a leading composition teacher of the 20th century, Nadia Boulanger.
It was like a miracle, because a lot of things she was talking about, I was not prepared to accept. She'd tell me things like, the more restrictions you place on your music, the more freedom you have, which was hard for me to accept at first, because a jazz player doesn't think like that.
She was an extraordinary lady. She knew anything. She knew, there is not one composer on earth who didn't work with Nadia Boulanger when she was alive. Not one.
I asked her about orchestration one day, and she said, Quincy, before we talk about orchestration, I want you to take the first 25 bars of Daphne and Chloe by Ravel and reduce the entire transpose score down to 2 6-line sketches. So she says, now transpose it up all to 12 steps. And every time you go up, you notice something else. And she said, now we can talk. And it's true. It's learning your craft, you know.
He couldn't study full-time, too busy with his day job producing albums for Barclay Records. But after 2 years, he left the company. He was going to lead his own big band. His break came in 1959 with a musical called Free and Easy. Its American producers asked Quincy to try it out in Europe before they took it to Broadway. Quincy's school friend Buddy Catlett played bass in the band.
Free and Easy was a show about bits of the old South, about times after slavery.
The show was a hit, but closed early when violence erupted in Paris, linked to the war in Algeria. They were advised to go back to America, but Quincy decided to stay in France.
I said, forget it, man. My band is great. You know, I didn't care about music business. I just cared about the music. And I was, you know, very young. I was 26 then. I said, no, I'm going to stay over here.
He puts his mind into anything, endeavor he does. He makes it an enjoyable situation, a trip, so to speak. You know, it's Quincy Jones.
I had to do all of it, you know. Conduct the band at night, write arrangements sometime, and try to figure out where we're going to work next. Mainly where we're going to work next, you know.
They played gigs wherever they could get bookings, from Spain to Scandinavia to Yugoslavia.
Clark Terry, one of the greatest trumpet players that ever lived, influenced Miles Davis, everybody. And Quentin Jackson left Duke Ellington's band to come join my band. So the responsibility was like enormous, you know, and I had to come up and pay this man every week.
We were there and his money was running out. And so the idea was to keep paychecks coming. You just don't just drop it. You are working. He knew what it would be like to be on the road with no money. And some of us still had families here.
He came to Sweden and told me about it. It was quite a struggle because it was at a point where big bands were not so popular anymore.
So what do I do now? Okay, I'll book some jobs in Germany, where when we go to Germany, I can recoup the money we couldn't get out of Yugoslavia. So you were constantly, it was insane. I almost committed suicide in Finland. It was that bad.
Desperate and broke, he had to admit defeat and ask the record company Mercury to throw him a lifeline.
And Mercury bailed him out until the time we did come home. $80,000. At that time, that was a lot of money. It was like a release. And he did cry, because it was like all of the stress and strain that he went through. And so nothing left but to have a few tears.
1960 was the lowest point in Quincy's career. Mercury's injection of cash got the band back to America, but Quincy was left personally in debt. His marriage was on the rocks too. Soon after his return from Europe, Quincy and Jerry separated. Quincy's refuge, as always, was music. He threw himself into the New York recording business and bounced back remarkably quickly. An arrangement for his childhood friend Ray Charles was rewarded with the first Grammy nomination.
Hey, everybody, let's have some fun. You only live but once, and when you're dead, you're done. So let the good time roll. I said, let the good time roll.
Mercury Records now wanted him full-time, and in 1961, he made history as the first black executive at a major record label. He was 28.
Oh, that was definitely a breaking of barriers. That's something that hadn't been done before. The musicians were, you know, as we look at it now, the hired hands of the record labels, but we were never in a position to be part of the executive staff. And this was Mercury Records, which was a major label at that time.
All you got to do is get together and let the good time roll.
That was a big change for a lot of people, him getting that high up position in the company. Top banana, you know, so to speak.
When he first started to work at Mercury, I remember him talking to my dad about the fact that he was the first black executive in the record business and what that was going to entail and how he was going to function through that.
I mean, it was an amazing experience, you know. You're in charge of picking songs and picking artists, and hopefully you pick the right ones, you know.
Well, bless my soul, what's wrong with me?
Picking the right ones wasn't easy in the early 60s. Rock and roll had taken the world by storm, but Quincy was sticking with the very best of jazz. I'm all shook up.
The Sarah Vaughans, Nina Simone's, Demita Joe's, Donny Washington's, etc. They sold, but I mean, they didn't sell like the Roger Millers, you know, and the big sellers. And so they said, why don't you make a hit record? And I was cocky then. I said, it's not such a big deal, you know. And so I found, we were at a meeting in Chicago, and they were throwing this record around, and I grabbed it. Well, now nobody knows where my
Johnny is gone, but you know. Quincy found a new singing talent to record the number, a 16-year-old called Leslie Gore. He arranged the score and doubled the voice track to get the effect he wanted. It was number one in America and number nine in the UK in June 1963.
And we ended up doing 18 hits with her. In fact, she just sang with me in Washington, D.C. last month.
Jazz, Leslie Gore. From jazz to It's My Party and I'll Cry If I Want To. Come on. Doesn't get more eclectic than that.
Every album I've ever made has been very eclectic, you know. Because I don't like categories. I really don't. At all. And I don't like somebody's limitations to say you can't play that, because that means that I can't write classical music. Just because jazz is like the classical music of popular music. It really is.
Some of the jazz world accused him of selling out.
I hate people that say things like that. People that say, you know, Quincy Jones should have stayed with jazz or whatever they say. To me, that shows that their viewpoint is in a box. The beauty of life is to be outside the box so that the box doesn't exist. You know, so that you have such a broader palette to work with expression. I mean, music serves a purpose. Expressing truth, expressing beauty, expressing reality, and also expressing dreams and hopes. And to limit a human being to one mode of expression is really a crime.
He just sought to broaden his horizons. And his great gift from the world of jazz did much to lift the quality of music and the quality of arrangements in the popular cultural world. So the world benefited by Quincy having made that move. I think what the jazz community may have disliked was that he was now becoming less and less available, and therefore they felt the sting of his absence.
Quincy was actually embracing both worlds in 1963. As well as his success in the pop charts, he also won his first Grammy for an arrangement of I Can't Stop Loving You for his mentor, Count Basie. He certainly had the Midas touch. In 1964, he went to Las Vegas to work with the biggest star in show business.
Fly me to the moon. Let me play up there with those stars. Let me see what life is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand. In other words, darling, kiss me.
You don't call up and say, Mr. Sinatra, Quincy Jones wants to work with you. Forget that. It doesn't work like that. He has to call you first. So say, Q. Somebody ever called me that before. And this is Frank. I heard an arrangement you did for Basie in his last album, Hits of the 50s and 60s, on In Other Words. The name of the song was In Other Words. It was a waltz. Bart Howard wrote this waltz.
Fly me to the moon and let me play among the stars.
Quincy changed the time signature and made it swing.
And Frank said, that's the way I want to record, the way you did it. Did it in 4/4 to do boo doo bit boop. I said, I would love you to do an album with Basie and I. Are you interested? And I said, man, is the Pope a Catholic? I was so thrilled, I can't tell you. Sinatra? I mean, this is him at his peak.
Luck let a gentleman see just how nice a dame you can be. I know the way you treated other men you've been with, but luck be a lady with me.
Not everyone knows that Quincy Jones arranged some of the most famous hits carried by Frank Sinatra.
Yes, he should. That's who should carry it, you know. I mean, I was just a conductor and arranger, that's all. And happy as I could be. One of the most incredible experiences ever was working with Basie and Sinatra. Jump, Q, jump.
Their 1965 album, Live at the Sands, has inspired many musicians down the years.
I found out by looking at the cover that it was Quincy's arrangements and conducting. And it was just like it was a great band, a great night. Sinatra was at a peak, and it was... So that really, really made me aware that he would have been like God at that point.
But in 1965, a new generation was sweeping big bands aside.
When the big band world really started to dry up completely, and he was getting a lot of pressure from people to stay and hold down the fort. And I remember vividly Quincy saying, no, I don't. I have to do what works for my life. And right now, I need to be scoring films, and that's what I'm going to go after.
And that's exactly what he did. His first commission was for Sidney Lumet, who asked Quincy to write a jazz score for his next film. As he'd never written one before, he consulted an old friend who was now an accomplished film composer.
He came to me in Paris and he said, Michel, you have to help me. He said, I never did a score and I don't know how do we work it. So we sat down and I explained the stopwatch and the seconds and the things. I explained to him how to do it.
Like anything else, there's a lot of things you have to learn. Learn the hard way, you know. But I listened to the guy. I always was smart enough to listen to the guys who knew what they were doing.
The Pawnbroker starred Rod Steiger, Oscar nominated for his performance as a concentration camp survivor.
The first time I heard Quincy's film score, of course, it was his first, which was Pawnbroker, and he did such an amazing. I heard of Quincy Jones that I'd never heard before.
Quincy's score was a great success. It combined what he'd learned about orchestration from Nadia Boulanger in Paris with his instinctive talent for jazz.
Waiting for this all my life, you know, just to play hooky, to go see movies, and I just felt like I was born to write movies, you know.
But as an African-American, he was not made universally welcome.
Yeah, Hollywood was, both Purcell White over there, yeah, at that time.
In the movie business, you know, that's a close circle, and to get in there, he had to do some work, you know.
Having been the first black executive in the record industry, Quincy was now one of the very few black composers in Hollywood. Further afield, Martin Luther King was rallying public opinion against racial prejudice.
I think this march will go down as one of the greatest, if not the greatest, demonstrations for freedom and human dignity ever held in the United States.
In 1967, Hollywood confronted the issue of racism in a seminal film.
In the heat of the night, seems like a cold sweat creeping across my brow. Yeah.
I got the motive, which is money, and the body, which is death.
You're holding the wrong man.
But don't you push me, boy.
They call me Mr. Tibbs.
What kind of people are you?
Challenge with any movie is to be true to the movie, you know, and you're dealing with, again, science and soul, because you have to deal with the synchronization first, and that's not soulful. That's very mechanical. And you have to get that out of the way so you can get to your soul and make it feel like one piece of music that fits everything. If you're in an interior shot, close up on somebody, and then the camera goes outside with a telephoto lens to 3,000 people, you can't play the same music, you know? So you've got to make one piece of music sound organically, like it belongs.
One of Quincy's greatest challenges was the score for another film of 1967. The disturbing true life story of two men who murdered a whole family in their home.
In cold blood. An appalling and apparently senseless crime.
Quincy was at his most inventive, using human sounds like mouth pops and hand slaps as part of the score. The score was a triumph, nominated for an Oscar, and to this day, a favorite of Quincy's. He had now met his second wife, Ulla Andersson, a Swedish model.
Ulla was much, much younger than Quincy, and this absolutely magnificent specimen. She was a champion swimmer at the Olympics, and she was, at that time, when she hooked up with Quincy, she was the second or the third biggest model in the world. This was before supermodels, but at that time it was Twiggy, Varushka, and Ulla.
She was 19, he was 32. Within 3 years, they had two children, a son, Quincy Jones III, and a daughter, Martina.
When he first saw her, he said he was at this party, and he looked across the room, and all he saw was legs. So basically, that was his, you know, that was his description of, you know, how he saw my mom.
It was like instant. And I believe they moved in together, like, immediately, like, in the first week or so. You know, knowing my father, that would make sense.
Quincy was there for the beauty, you know. He is a slave to beauty. He always has been. A slave to beauty and to booty. And she had both.
Quincy's Hollywood career blossomed throughout the marriage, but he missed making music for its own sake. In 1969, he took a break from movies to record his first album for 3 years, Walking in Space.
And I said, I just want to get in the studio with my favorite musicians and just freak, just do our thing.
He decided to use electric guitars as well as orchestral instruments to produce a jazz-pop fusion from the smooth jazz of Killer Joe to the surprise Edwin Hawkins gospel hit, Oh Happy Day. The album he did simply to get into the studio with friends and freak won Quincy his second Grammy.
I think Quincy would agree that having a foundation in jazz is one that is really fundamental in allowing us kind of a solid foundation for being able to explore all those different territories and mix different genres, because jazz in itself is eclectic, and that's how it's continued to survive for more than a century. And it's people like Quincy Jones that are the seeds, part of the seed and the catalyst for the growth of jazz.
Quincy produced albums and scored films for the next decade. Ever versatile, in 1969, he wrote the music for a very British film, The Italian Job. It was an icon of 60s style, from the Mini to Michael Caine as working class hero.
Go! You're only supposed to blow the bloody doors off!
The producer's idea of using Quincy Jones surprised the film's star.
When they said, we're making an English movie about a load of English football fans, you know? And he said, we're bringing over an American jazz composer to do the score. We went, what is he, nuts?
I wanted to be a Brit. I wanted to make it sound like a Brit wrote it, because I wanted it to sound like British music hall, mixed with Cockney slang and so forth.
He sort of made the film. If you've seen the film, the whole score was written by Quincy. And one of the great things about The Italian Job is the score. You know, it's fantastic.
Self-Preservation Society was for the guys escaping in the bus. It's the Self-Preservation Society. The
Self-Preservation Society. Quincy even persuaded Michael to sing on the track.
Yeah, yeah, we all sing that. We all sang that. Yeah, I sang it. I'll do anything.
I said, let's go there. Let's go all the way British Music Hall and Cockney slang. And it was so exciting, because when I see the soccer teams on TV now at the World Cup sing that, I told you, it gives me goosebumps. It's such a nice feeling.
But how many football fans know who wrote the track?
You're hearing this great score, but you're not sitting in a movie saying, isn't that a great score by Quincy Jones? You didn't even know who wrote the score, you know, when you you left before the credits.
Through the 60s and 70s, Quincy scored over 50 films and television series, including this unforgettable theme for Ironside. He's considered to be one of the best film composers of his era. Quincy's personal life was less successful. His marriage to Ulla broke down. She says she never felt truly loved by Quincy and was an outsider in his circle.
I mean, you don't marry somebody you don't love, you know. And I think once that has happened, no matter what the outcome is, that they always have an apartment in your heart, you know.
They separated in 1972, and later Ulla took the children to Sweden to start a new family life away from Hollywood.
They loved each other a lot, and I know that from what I've talked to her about, that I think that, you know, she truly felt that he was her one and only.
I think what probably went wrong is that they were just too young. The premise, I think, was just tough. A model and a jazz musician, you know. She's 19, he's, what, 30-something. It's a tough one.
Quincy kept in touch with the children, but living an ocean apart made things difficult. He'd also kept in touch with Jolie, his daughter from his first marriage. Now 16 and a model, Jolie was instrumental in introducing Quincy to his third wife, actress Peggy Lipton.
I met him in a very interesting situation where I was dating somebody else and he was still married.
And then I broke up with Ulla. She called my daughter and said, do you think your father is interested in me?
And she said, well, you're probably on his list.
My daughter said, you're in the top 10. It's terrible.
So about 3 weeks later, I got a call from Jolie, and she said, would you like to have dinner with me? And she said, my dad's going to be coming. So I said, okay. And I was so excited that I waited outside my house. I didn't even let them come in. And we went to dinner, and from that night on, we were together for 14 years. I would say it was instant chemistry for both of us.
Can you feel it?
In the early 70s, Quincy's output was prolific. As well as writing film scores, he was the frontman for a range of smooth jazz and soul albums. In 1974, Body Heat almost went platinum.
The temperature's rising, and it's not surprising.
So I just love the sound of his records. That was a very Hugh Hefner sounding record, if you know what I mean. The kind of music you like, you know, like you expect to hear at the Playboy Mansion. You know what I mean? It was like smooth jazz before they had a name for it. I'm sure many people had sex to those records.
Life could hardly get better for Quincy. In 1974, their daughter, Kidada, arrived. But 3 months after the birth, disaster struck.
I was seeing double, and I felt like a shotgun had blown my brains out.
It happened quite suddenly, in fact. He literally, it burst, the aneurysm burst in his brain.
Aneurysm is equivalent to 16 strokes. And it's a congenital weakness in the main artery of the brain.
Immediately we associated aneurysm with immediate death, because if you go back at that time, and even today, many times that's fatal.
We didn't know what was going on. All I knew is that he passed out. It looked like he passed out. And I called the paramedics who came, and because I thought he was having a heart attack. And by the next day, he was in 9 hours of surgery to save his life.
We just stopped cold in our tracks, and we were on a plane the next day. And the first thing that happened when we got to see Quincy was the doctor gave us a diagnosis, a prognosis of where he was at that point in time. And it looked pretty dismal.
Quincy survived 2 major brain operations. This near-death experience had a profound effect.
I would say his life changed pretty much 100%. He didn't stress himself about the small things. He concentrated more on his music and what he could give and what he could contribute, and just like really lived with gratitude. From now on, every day was looked at as a gift.
He realized the loss of family, loved ones, and everything else that was precious and dear to him in life was just about gone, just like that.
I feel very blessed to, as I think of what would have happened if I had left the planet in 1974. Well, I would miss a lot of things.
By the age of 41, Quincy had produced more than most people do in a lifetime. But if he'd died then, he wouldn't have worked with the 1980s king of pop.
He'll make you do a thing until it's perfect.
In part 2, find out what it takes to make the world's best-selling album.
Try to find a group of songs that touch you, that give you goosebumps.
Follow Quincy's story as he produces the world's best-selling single. And track his rise to become a multi-award-winning living legend.